Ezekiel 25:17. The path of the righteous man is beset on all sides by the iniquities of the selfish and the tyranny of evil men.
Language and dialogue are two words that obviously cannot be separated. The way that we talk to each other, the way we communicate, is reliant on language in our everyday lives, just as it is for the characters in the movies we watch. And yet, as much as art is supposed to mirror life, or at least that's how the saying goes, all too often that does not apply to these very things, the way we talk and what we hear. Why doesn't Jules talk the way normal people do? And more importantly, why and how does it work so well?
Still a little bit depressed about, you know, the giant smoldering funeral pyre in the middle of town. MoveOn.org, needy. It's over. Life is too short to be moping around about some white trash pig roast.
This is Jennifer's Body, a movie that's developed a strange cult following since its release nearly a decade ago. A movie that was written by Diablo Cody. You might recognize her name. She was also the person that put pen to paper on Juno. In these two movies, you get the same kind of dialogue with wildly different results. Characters in Juno and in Jennifer's Body do not talk like human beings do. They don't communicate the way that we do.
I think the first one was defective. The plus sign looks more like a division symbol, so I remain unconvinced.
Third test today, Mama Bear. Your ego is prego, no doubt about it.
They speak in catchphrases and non-existent slang. I call it quirk dialogue. This works incredibly well in Juno. Our main character speaks in clever slang-laden riddles, and it comes across as charming and character-appropriate. But it works mostly because of the quirky and at times immature way that Juno communicates and expresses herself amongst other people nicely juxtaposes the more mature and harsh subject matter and thematic content of the film. Juno is a portraiture of divorce, of teenage pregnancy, of struggle and identity. It makes sense that teenage Juno would quirk her way through this environment. We've never really seen a character like Juno in a film like this before. In Jennifer's Body, on the other hand, you have a movie about vampires and teenage lust. Yes, if you dig deep enough, you get a mature foundation, but here, Diablo Cody's dialogue feels like it's amplifying characters we've seen before and amps up that feeling of immaturity. That vain cheerleader, the girl next door, the geeky boyfriend, suddenly that quirk dialogue feels like a gimmick stuffed in between these cliches. It doesn't support the narrative, the characters, or the story, it just kind of exists. See, dialogue, not just the words, but the style, needs to exist and function with purpose. It needs to fit the world and the thematic content of the movie you're writing. Which is what's so great about this.
But I have to go see.
Come on, you don't have to study, you don't have to study, let's just talk.
I can't.
Why?
Because it is exhausting. Dating you is like dating a stairmaster.
All I meant is that you're not likely to... currently. I wasn't making a comment on your parents. I was just saying that you go to BU. I was stating a fact, that's all. And if it seemed rude, then of course I apologize.
I have to go study.
You don't have to study.
Why do you keep saying I don't have to study?
Because you go to BU.
Insider did an incredible piece not too long ago about how Aaron Sorkin writes dialogue. In it, they look at this scene here, the opening of David Fincher's The Social Network. The conclusion they came to was that in this scene, two things are happening. One, Sorkin is literally counting the syllables of his dialogue, but more importantly, he's repeating specific phrases far more than other dialogue writers. In this one scene, they counted 22 repeated sentences for a total of 15% of the scene being repeated at some point verbatim. See, Sorkin's writing style is precise. It's calculated. It is what some call heightened language dialogue. Sorkin's goal, as he put it, is to write characters that are smarter than everyone else, including Sorkin himself. To do so, he speeds his dialogue up and his characters' reaction times along with it to speeds simply impossible for us regular human beings to comprehend in real life. He uses words as weapons. They are tools for conflict, a way for characters to strike and strike back. And because his characters are as smart as they are, he's able to disorient and drag his eventual audience into situations that feel unpredictable. It's not the setup of a scene that throws us off guard, it's the words coming out of their mouths.
You're obsessed with finals clubs. You have finals clubs OCD and you need to see someone about it. We'll prescribe you some sort of medication. You don't care if the side effects may include blindness.
Final clubs. Not finals clubs.
See, people don't talk like Sorkin writes. They don't talk in speeches, but he's writing characters that maybe don't act like normal people either. Heightened language works for Sorkin. It works for his characters because he's writing heightened characters, and that consistency prevents that writing from feeling off or strange to the ear. Some see Sorkin's writing as a gimmick, but because it's consistent, it just feels like it's meant to exist that way. And it also results in a screenplay that's usually, in his words, 200 to 300 pages long. But then there's this in between.
For he is truly his brother's keeper and the finder of lost children. And I will strike down upon thee with great vengeance.
Tarantino is an interesting beast when it comes to writing. Some people have called what you just watched poetic language. But I think a more apt way to describe this kind of dialogue is ideal language. What I think makes Tarantino such an exceptional writer is that his language, his dialogue style, shifts from film to film. Pulp Fiction, however, may be the peak of his ideal language approach.
The point of the story isn't a little girl, the point of the story is they robbed a bank with a telephone.
You want to rob a bank?
I'm not saying I want to rob banks, I'm just illustrating that if we did, it'd be easier than what we've been doing.
And no more liquor stores?
What we've been talking about, yeah, no more liquor stores.
People do not talk like this. Tarantino likes to extract the poetry of communication. He literally gives Jules a Bible verse to repeat throughout this film, but I think more interesting is how Tarantino has his actors speak the dialogue that's been written. See, Tarantino is looking for the space in between, that gap that Sorkin closes. What he does so beautifully is pace dialogue. This is not naturalistic. And he does so in a way that makes even mundane conversations sound, well, like poetry. Every pause, every sip of a milkshake, Tarantino is letting conversation breathe in a way that we, as human beings, normally don't in our daily lives. There are very few interruptions, few mistakes, it's language at its most ideal, plotting poised and cerebral. Now, Tarantino doesn't always take this approach. In fact, he's gotten away from it almost entirely later in his career, but ideal language dialogue, when done well, can and often does make a scene feel like a moment, and gives you a chance to process and hopefully remember each and every word. It places an emphasis on ideas as opposed to those words. The problem, of course, with this is that what you're presenting has to be exceptional, has to be interesting, because you won't be able to outpace a bad idea like a Sorkin might. And then, sometimes, each and every one of these things gets thrown out the window for this.
I felt repulsed when you touched
you're
me.
You're a slob. I made all the beds, clothed all the cabinets,
I
picked out of you like an infant.
Makes me want to peel my skin off.
You'll never be happy. And now lay her anywhere.
Now this is how people talk. This is what is generally called naturalistic dialogue. This is how people speak. It is messy, it is chaotic, but it is true to life because that is, again, how we as human beings communicate. The beauty of naturalistic dialogue is that assuming your movie is a movie that takes place in the present, you can almost never go wrong with naturalism done right. The problem is, it's also incredibly difficult to get right. See, naturalistic dialogue is special because it gives your audience a chance to truly suspend their disbelief. It becomes so easy to believe in your characters, their problems, and their relationships when they speak the way we hear people speak every day. Noah Baumbach is a master of naturalistic dialogue. He understands that in conflict, we don't let people
do not compare me to my father
finish. He understands that we don't always complete our
mother, everything you're complaining about what you're doing
thoughts, and importantly, he understands that we don't always have that much to say to begin with. Sometimes we're just talking to talk. We don't even respond directly to the person we're talking to. It's a non sequitur or a totally different path of conversation. See, naturalism in dialogue is about writing with human error in mind, about finding the mistakes and flaws in the way we speak to each other in a way that someone like Sorkin or Tarantino might remove. Sometimes we just fail at communicating, which, as a screenwriter, can be tough to accept because our first instinct as writers is to strive for perfection. Naturalistic dialogue, then, creates flawed people and flawed relationships, and when it works, it can be just as beautiful as all the people writing in the ways that don't sound the way we really do when we open our mouths. Dialogue is not necessarily something that will make or break every film. It certainly wasn't the primary focus of something like Mad Max Fury Road, but dialogue is as much of a stylistic decision as color, lens choices, or aspect ratio. One a writer makes before a director even comes on board to make those aforementioned choices for them. It's about more than just what's said, it's how you choose to say it, every time you put your pen to paper. So, does it matter that this is not how people talk? Not really. In our day-to-day lives, we barely know how to communicate with each other to begin with. What's much more important is that we know why we're saying the things we say and the reasons we're saying them the way we are. That's just the human condition, the human flaw of not being on the same page of everybody all the time. That's how we successfully communicate. Everything in between is just words lost on a keyboard.
Oh man, I shot Marvin in the face.
And that is it for today's episode of Nerdstalgic. If you guys enjoyed the video, press that like button down below. Also, don't forget to hit subscribe if you haven't yet done so. And next to the subscribe button is a little bell. If you hit that little bell, to make sure you're notified when I upload. On your screen right now, of course, are all of our amazing patrons for the month. On Patreon, you're getting a really cool film podcast called Film Panic. It's a competitive film podcast with a bunch of other YouTubers. You're getting review videos of shows, of movies. You're getting a commentary track called The Cut. There's just a lot of stuff on Patreon, a lot of extra content, including Nerdstalgic videos that just never made the cut here or maybe couldn't go up here for some reason. So check out the Patreon. I'll put the link in the description below. This video was sponsored by Filmora. It is a super easy to use and tailor-made video editor for beginners. If you're just getting into YouTubing, if you're just getting into content creation, this is probably the video editor for you. I actually stumbled across it trying to help a friend get into YouTube. It supports video recorder, picture-in-picture, audio fine-tuning. Basically, everything you need to really get started is included in Filmora. And that includes some of the effects work that you see in a lot of YouTube videos. Things like the pop video effects, the transitions, filters, and Filmora, some of which you're seeing right now. They'll help make early videos, especially the ones when you're just getting the hang of things, a bit better and pop a bit more. Filmora has this really, really cool Hollywood-style video contest going on right now. You make a video using Filmora 9 or Filmstock. You share your video publicly on YouTube, this platform right here, and include hashtag made with Filmora in the title, and then you submit your video link for them to review. You could win a ton of cool stuff, so keep that in mind as well. Down below, you can find a link in the description for a free download of Filmora. Again, if you want to start creating content, if you're just trying to get a hang of things, or just trying to find out if video editing is something you're even interested in, this is a great way to do it. You can click the link in the description, download Filmora, and give those things a shot.